I haven't sentimentalized my relationship with my sourdough. I'm like, you are a culture of yeast and you are gonna work for me. You have no name. So literally it was like within a span of like 5 weeks, I lost 6 jobs.
Here I was at the end of my second year, my workshop show had been canceled. I felt like my two-part launch pad, you know, for my future, half of it had just dissolved away. And I was like, well, crap, what am I supposed to do now? Yeah. And after talking with Val and doing a lot of meditating and stuff, it was like, you know, my goal was to be an excellent director. Now it's about becoming an excellent artist, cultivating practices of creativity and habits of manifesting new work.
This was a value that you, Deb, would instill into the actors, and to some degree the directors, but mostly the actors, was in a system that affords you very little power and agency, how do you create agency? Mm-hmm. And that was, did they still do solo shows at UW?
Yes, I just did mine. I did mine online. That was my, in our last quarter was.
Directors do solo shows too?
We do solo shows now.
Whew. Bless you. I'm like, there's no way you cannot get me to act anything. No way. I was just like, but I'm so glad. But yeah, but the idea was that, right, the there was a culture of like, well, we're not going to send you out there to wait for someone to hire you. You're going to go out there with material. You're going to go out there knowing what your skills are so that you can make work for yourself and you stay trained and you stay active and present and engaged. I also miss working. I mean, that's what I found, that yes, we just miss working, because a lot of times for us in the theater, the work is my, this is how I live, right? I live by making my art. And yes, there's a kind of logistical employment part of it, but that's actually why when I didn't go into this field because I wanted to make a paycheck. I got into this field because it actually fed me as a human being to do the thing I'm doing. And so to be kind of locked out of this opportunity to be in community, it's really hard. I think that's a lot of what folks are craving too.
To be back in the room. We want to be in the room.
Yeah, in this moment of, I don't know, this cryogenic state that we kind of find the theater system to be in. Right? People keep asking me whether or not, like, oh, is the theater in trouble? And I'm like, no, theater as an art form is not in trouble. Theater making as a producing model, as we've known it for the last 40 years, that might be in trouble, right? Relying on foundational revenue for things, that might be in trouble. Your idea of a 5-show season subscription model might be in trouble. Mm-hmm. But those are like economic concerns, right? That's not the art itself. We're always gonna wanna tell stories. We're gonna wanna gather. We're gonna want, right? This is not theater.
No.
Capital T is not in trouble.
No, theater will survive. We will survive. And I'm actually excited for what's next. I think at first I was really, you know, when this all began, I was really nervous. Like I said, I was sitting back being like, what's next? What's next? Oh God, I don't know what's next. I'm going to graduate into a world I don't know.
Like, that's great, because you get to make it.
Exactly. And that's when I flipped the question. Instead of asking what's next and waiting, I was asking myself, well, what do I want to see in what's next? I want theater that tells a story that needs to be heard now. I want to create spaces for intersectional creative development where we can connect as community and individuals. Let's create art that creates spaces that are equitable and equal and celebratory of individual journeys. You know, I love that we started to talk about this, and I want to talk about it more. This idea that you know, this social revolution that's happening in our world, you know, and how that's changing things. We have the We See You, Fine American Theater, happening. And many theaters are addressing those questions and those demands, which, you know, I think is great and wonderful steps in the right direction, you know, to create more open and equitable spaces for BIPOC artists. But in your journey looking forward, what do you think about, or what are you looking forward to when we are able to get back in person and with this new form of theater on the other side.
I don't know.
Which are three of the most beautiful, powerful words in the world. I don't know. Let's find out.
There's a lot of like, and I'm like, yay, BIPOC work. Do all that BIPOC work, white American theater. But where's the wealth going to those theaters? Right?
Yes.
I totally understand, but I'm kind of tired of being made. I mean, yes, thank you for making more space for me inside your institution. But when will the theaters from my community actually have the resources to build their own thing?
Right.
Okay. And so I am, and I think, of course, you have to do both, right? You have to like help white folks put out the fire again. Mm-hmm. It's like, you know, you can do, these are fires that you've started, right? These are your fires. And so I always feel a little torn. What do I want to see? Like, I don't know if I don't know if the thing that I want to see is not going to come without a lot of fire and brimstone.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and I, you know, and it's hard because I say this as someone who has worked quite prolifically in white American theater. And so I am 100% saying that I am playing a role in this too, that I think the future that is probably most equitable is the future where I don't have a job for a long time. I think in some ways I've been able to do the work I've been doing because I have been seen as like a unicorn. I'm like the Asian director who can do Shakespeare and a musical. And I mean, there's a kind of like, when theaters want to diversify, I'm like top of the list to like pluck and put in the season to be like, look how diverse we are. I got Desdemona Chiang directing a Shakespeare, right? And I get that, and I agree to that, right? And I try to, even when I go inside those systems, to like, what else can I disrupt here so that I'm not always like one of two Asians that come here to work at your theater? And it's hard because I feel like I have to be like, I cannot have a job. I have to be okay with me like not having a job. Or at least I cannot have the job that I am used to having, that I have been used to having for the last 5 years, right? And so I don't know how I feel about that. I mean, this is my own figuring out my role in being silent inside the kind of theater, the problematic structures of the American theater, right? I have learned to navigate those problems and survive within those problems as opposed to disrupting the system. And I feel in the conversations I've had with colleagues and like, you know, who are both producers and freelancers, I feel like there's a sincere desire to make change, but I also feel like there's not a lot of conversations around the willingness to see pain as a result of said changes. No one's talking about, okay, this is gonna hurt. This means we're not gonna hire a lot of our friends, right? People are talking about how much work they want to do, but not how much they're willing to endure in terms of the difficulty. And that's the part I worry about. I kind of go, there still seems to be this notion that it's not gonna be deeply painful, whether that means maybe your company won't exist, painful. In the scope of a larger benefit to the ecosystem, it might be that your company won't exist. So I think that's hard because we're talking about a collective movement. We're talking about an industry-wide movement that wants to happen. And there's no world where I see the industry doing what it wants to do and every single theater surviving.
Right. I guess my question is, as someone who has been in my shoes and has walked the journey much further than I have so far, what advice do you have for someone like me who is going into my final year into a world of theater that is a bit unknown? What advice do you have?
In your third year, there's often a kind of preoccupation with the thesis. And I think be careful of falling into the trap of your thesis being the thing you focus on, because what I found myself dreading was the moment after the thesis. I did my thesis in February. Was a spring thesis. And I just remember thinking, okay, where am I going to be in May, June of 2009? And I just looked up every single internship. I wanted to have a place to go in July, because I assumed that it was going to be an unwelcoming competitive world, and I wanted to be ready as much as I could. And I was kind of indiscriminate about who I sent things to. And I applied for things not knowing why I would take them, but I applied anyway to every fellowship internship program in town, out of town, LA, New York, Chicago, all over the place, because I knew I wanted to work nationally. I didn't know how. Mm. So I don't know if I recommend that. It might be exhausting to do that, but I think I was just so consumed with fear. And I know Val has a whole thing about fear, like no naming the fear. Yes, now I was like, yep, that's the fear. That's what I'm afraid of. And here's what I'm going to do to deal with it. Apply. And that's kind of what I did.
What I hear and what I really appreciate, because I've caught myself getting, you know, too focused on the thesis. Yeah. And what I hear in this advice is, yes, face the fear in the room, address the fear, take action against that fear, make the path. Do the work, make your thesis, and then get out and do the damn thing.
Yeah, because in many ways, like the thesis is the thing and for a long time, it was the thing that I was the most proud of, and no one gave a shit, ultimately, right? It meant so much to me. It meant so much. It was like, oh my God, such an achievement. The collaboration, the actors, like I wept when it closed. I was so sad to see it go. So I was really knit to it. And then looking back on it, like no job prospect ever was like, tell me about your thesis. Mm. No one ever asked me about my thesis project.
Because it's just another show.
It's another show, but treat it as the thing that you want to be proud of. But mm-hmm. I would not regard it as a kind of like thing you put in the world as a business gesture or a career move. Because it's not the make or break thing. Yeah, and it's also in the scope of professional work. It's like, it's a thing you did in grad school.
And you did it, and you're here, and you're alive. You didn't die. And you're going to go on and create more art, like you have.